Phoenix Mayor Greg Stanton will be in Las Vegas tomorrow at the invitation of the White House for President Obama's announcement on immigration reform. Mayor Stanton is here every month at our invitation to discuss issues affecting Phoenix. The mayor joins us now. Good to see you, Mayor. Thanks for joining us.
Always good to be on the show. Thank you.
You're in Las Vegas for the president's immigration speech, correct?
I will be there on a flight early morning and see the president about noon tomorrow.
Talk about immigration reform. Talk about the issue in Arizona. I mean, this is obviously divisive. What new is happening?
Well, it seems that good policy and good politics are coming together right at the right time. And there was a big announcement today by the bipartisan group of senators, including our own two senators, Senator Flake and Senator McCain. I'm very proud of them for stepping up to the plate, announcing some principles of immigration reform, which includes comprehensive immigration reform. I don't know what the president is going to announce tomorrow, but I expect it will be very much along the same vein. It seems that in a very bipartisan way, common sense is going to prevail, and we will see comprehensive immigration reform during this legislative session.
What influence can a mayor have in this debate?
Well, to be frank, I think people still listen to mayors. I think people look at cities and look at mayors and view us as functional forms of government. They may have lost a lot of confidence in Washington, D.C. because some of the craziness that's going on back there. And I think they look at cities and still say, we have confidence in those folks. And I think mayors represent Main Street America. We represent real business, mom and pop business. And I believe strongly that good, strong, comprehensive immigration reform is good for our local economy. Passage of the DREAM Act is going to be great for our local economy. And we need to get past the divisiveness and focus in on smart economic development policy, and immigration reform will help us a lot here in Arizona.
A recent quote of yours that got some attention, we should never let border security get in the way of the economy. What did you mean by that?
I'll tell you exactly what I meant by that. Look, we should have good, strong border security policy, but we shouldn't focus in on border security and not be able to do trade with our friends down in Mexico. We know that Mexico is our number one trade partner and is only going to grow as a trade partner. There's a lot of jobs to be had here in Arizona, high-wage jobs associated with international trade, particularly in Mexico. So as we deal with the difficult issues of immigration, as we focus in on fighting the drug cartels, which are still a problem, let's not do it in a way that doesn't allow us to grow our economy and increase trade with Mexico. One shouldn't be the opposite of the other. We can accomplish both at the same time. And I think that good, comprehensive immigration reform will go a long way to help us accomplish that goal.
Have we not accomplished both here in recent years?
Well, the reality is this. In Arizona, we have a long way to go when it comes to increasing trade with Mexico. And in part, it's because of some of the divisive bills that have been passed over the last few years. And we have to send a very different message. That's why it's so important that Senator McCain and Senator Flake are leading on this effort. That here in Arizona, we're not divisive. We're a welcoming place. We're focused in on smart priorities like jobs, economic development, and education. Those have to be our priorities moving forward. And trade with Mexico and the economic development opportunities that go along with it are really, really important. And we're not going to pass short-term divisive policies that don't help us in the long run in helping our economy and creating jobs here in Arizona.
I know that you mentioned immigration reform when you were back in Washington. You criticized Washington for inaction on the budget. What can D.C. do right now? I mean, there is gridlock back there. The Senate goes one way, the House goes the other. I mean, at what point does a mayor just basically say, do your best and come on back home?
Well, let me talk about unfortunate Washington action on two issues. First and foremost is immigration reform. The lack of action back in Washington on this critically important issue has hurt us back here in Arizona, has frustrated people here in Arizona. It's frustrated me for a long period of time. I hope and pray we can get that right now. On the budget, look, there was some activity on taxes on New Year's Day, the so-called fiscal cliff. People need to understand they did not solve the issue of sequestration. Sequestration, if it goes through, will be devastating to a local economy, hurting about 50,000 jobs, eliminating about 50,000 jobs, including almost 40,000 jobs in defense and aerospace. We have to fight it. It's not good public policy. It's not good for our economy. It could send us back into a recession. We understand that cuts have to be made, but sequestration was never meant to be actual public policy. It was meant to scare members of Congress, and unfortunately, they couldn't get together and reach bipartisan compromise. So we still have the looming threat of sequestration hanging over our heads, and I'm a big city mayor, and I'm going to fight that.
But if they're not scared by sequestration, what's going to work?
Oh, I think that they will be scared by sequestration once the American people realize what an incredible threat it is to our local economy. Look, the economy is starting to do better. We're crawling out from underneath this terrible recession we have gone through. We can't allow Washington to do something that potentially would send us back into recession. So the American people have to have their voices heard. And I think once people realize the amount of job loss that could be created if sequestration goes through, they're going to hear from Arizona loud and clear.
Are you really planning a march on Washington regarding this?
Well, there's a group of mayors who have gotten together. I chair the sequestration task force through the U.S. Conference of Mayors. And so, yes, we're going to use that bully pulpit that we have and to go speak our minds in Washington. And again, I think that mayors still have a voice. I think people still listen to us. They listen to city leadership. We represent Main Street America, and I plan to use that voice to fight for jobs here in Arizona.
Your critics are saying they listened to you during the campaign, regarding the food tax and how you wanted that ended as soon as possible. It's still there, and we're not seeing it ending anytime soon. What's going on with that?
Sure. First off, I was very frustrated by how the food tax went into place. It was done with 24 hours notice. It shouldn't have been done that way. And I was very critical of the process during the course of the campaign. I suggested, look, we should try to get rid of the food tax as soon as we can. Let's do it in a balanced way, make sure it doesn't hurt public safety or other core services. I have asked the city manager to present a budget to the city council that includes the food tax and one that doesn't include the food tax. And now we're going to go through a very public process, as we should, as we always do through the budget process, and allow the public to contact myself and the other members of the council about whether they like the choices that would have to be made. We have to make sure that the mistakes that were made at the beginning don't happen now as we go through this important process.
I guess the critics, though, would say that doesn't sound like as soon as possible.
Well, look, my campaign, how I've governed during my first year as mayor, is exactly what I promised during the course of the campaign. Those commitments are very, very important. I committed to support local business, and we've done a ton in that regard. I committed to support increased transparency at the city, and we've done a ton. And I committed on pension reform. And we have a ballot initiative in March that will save the city a lot of money. So I've got a pretty strong record on keeping my commitments, and I'm also got a strong record of doing what I can to support public safety and to support our bond rating, credit rating. And so as a leader, I'm going to do everything I can to support those issues.
But is there a problem with the message when people point out that the tax is still there and pay raises are given to city employees? That's going on as well. They see a problem there. Do you see a problem?
Well,
there?
Here's what I voted on, to be perfectly frank. I did support the memorandum of understanding with our labor groups that restored the pay cut that was implemented a few years ago during the almost $300 million budget deficit at the city. We've done a pay study to look at where our city employees rank in terms of other cities and other comparable jobs, and seeing that our city, in terms of our salary structure, is not out of line. We have made a commitment with certain jobs that are out of line to try to fix that so we can be competitive in terms of recruiting and retaining the very best employees. And so on the issue of working with our labor groups and whether or not it's a pay raise when you're restoring the cuts that were made, I mean, I don't want to get a semantical battle, but I want to be as frank as possible with people.
But I guess again, what people will say is, you're a politician, you know how things look and how things appear. Food tax still in place, pay raises going on. That gets a lot of folks riled up.
Yeah, well, let me be, again, perfectly frank what we're going to do. I've asked the city manager to prepare a budget with the food tax. I've asked the city manager to prepare the budget without the food tax. We're going to go through an incredibly public process. We're going to have a record number of public budget hearings. We're going to be taking testimony online. I'll be doing a live online televised budget hearing where people can ask questions. We've won awards for how transparent our process is. And so it's important that we go through the process. And people on that very issue you just described, people have a full and fair opportunity to get their point across, of course.
How long will all that take?
Next few months. This is all going to happen over the next 3 months in the city. We're following the regular budget timeline. I just want to make sure that the budget is go through even more transparency so that we have as much public input and involvement as possible.
And the pension reform issue hits the ballot when?
In early March. We have voted on the council. We unanimously voted on the city council to put pension reform on the ballot. If it is supported by the voters, and I'm confident that it will be, it will save the city over $600 million over the next 20 to 25 years. Essentially, we're asking our city employees to pay more in order to receive the pension. And so that's exactly what's going to occur. As employees come into the city, instead of the current system where right now it's about a 4-to-1 disparity in terms of what a city employee pays versus the city pays, we're going to be asking that be evened out. So it'd be a partnership at 50-50. By doing so, we're going to save the city general fund, again, hundreds of millions of dollars over the next 20, 25 years. It is smart public policy. It's good, strong public policy. It'll save the taxpayers a lot of money. It's the right thing to do.
Last question, the guns, the issue of background checks and those sorts of things. I know you want background checks improved, increased, background checks for everyone who buys a gun. Again, you're mayor of a major city, but how much can you move this process along?
Well, again, this is going to be one of the hot issues back in Washington now. By the way, I hope that the gun issue and the issue of gun safety doesn't get in the way of immigration reform. We need to move forward with immigration reform right now. Now is the time. But I do believe that universal background checks are good common sense improvements to the issue of gun safety. Look, we want to minimize to the extent possible, take common sense approaches. We support the Second Amendment. I support the Second Amendment. But universal background check, I think, is a good common sense approach to make sure we know who's acquiring these weapons. And I think we require it of gun stores, and we ought to make sure that we require it for other type of gun sales as well. I think it makes common sense.
What about high-capacity magazines?
Well, I did sign on to the U.S. Conference of Mayors letter to the president asking for improvements on the issue of gun violence and gun safety. We want to reduce the amount of gun violence, and that was one of the recommendations that we made.
All right. Mayor, good to see you. Thanks for joining us.
As always, great to be on. Thank you.